In this video, I'm going to show you how to make a custom NPC like you might see over on Hypixel that'll let you join a certain game when you click on it. In order to do this, we're going to use NMS and Protocol Lib. So if you ever wanted to learn a little bit more about either one of these two topics, this is the right video for you. I'm going to explain how this code works line by line so you can spawn your very own NPC on your server. And if you watch all the way to the end of the video, I'll show you how to download this code for yourself. So let's jump right in. I've got my NPC class open here, which implements this NPC protocol so that I can update this project when another Minecraft version comes out. And the reason I'm writing my code this way is because whenever Minecraft updates their server, my code will break because I'm using NMS. NMS, if you're not familiar, stands for net.minecraft.server, and every NMS class also has a version in it. In my case, this is v116r3, and this will change whenever the Minecraft server version gets updated. You might have heard of reflection, which is a way that you could get around this, which I actually have included in the project, which you can take a look at a little bit later. But in this video, I'm going to explain just the NPC using raw NMS code. So let me explain how the process of adding an NPC to your world works. First, you need to create the entity player, which will represent your NPC character in-game. Then you need to show it to a specific player and spawn it into the world. After that, we can do a really cool thing where the NPC will follow a player as they move around. Of course, this is entirely optional, but it's fairly easy, and I highly recommend you try things like this because they're really fun. So taking a look inside of our constructor for the NPC, you'll notice at the very end, after we set up some properties, we call the addToWorld method, passing in the location that we'd like this NPC to spawn at. The first step in creating an entity player is getting a few different parameters, the first of which is the Minecraft server. This is an NMS class, and we can retrieve this by casting the bucket server to craft server and then calling get server on that craft server. And if that doesn't make too much sense to you, don't worry, because this isn't exactly supposed to be straightforward. Just try your best to follow along, and if you need help, you can join our Discord, or if you make it to the end of the video, I'll show you how to get all of this code for yourself, which is a working copy of the plugin to make sure that you haven't made any mistakes. Next, we have to get the world server, which is done very similarly to the Minecraft server. We cast the locations world to craft world, and then we call get handle, which returns this thing called a world server. After that, we can create this player interact manager using the world server, and then create a new entity player, which again is our NPC, and then we pass in the Minecraft server, the world server, the game profile, and the interact manager that we just created. And last but certainly not least, in the addToWorld method, we call setLocation on the entity player so that it's positioned correctly in the world. Now, if you're confused about where the game profile comes from, I'm going to show you that method next. As you can see, we have this makeGameProfile method. A game profile just represents the name as well as the skin on an NPC. And it's super simple. We just pass in the UUID of the NPC, its name, and then we add this textures property, which contains the texture and signature of our skin. I have another video that I'll share at the end of this one, which will tell you a little bit more about game profiles, which will help you change the skin on your NPC. Okay, so moving on, this is where we actually add the NPC into the world, so you could consider this the real meat of your NPC. I have this set at the top here, which contains the UUIDs of every single viewer of this NPC, because we might want to show this NPC to one player and not everybody else, or exclude one player and show it to everybody else. It really depends on what you're working on, and I highly recommend you contain a list of everybody you're showing this NPC to, so that you can hide it from them later. So the first thing inside of this showTo method is sending this thing called a packet playout player info. This is what tells the Minecraft client that a new player is added to the server. We signal that by passing in the add player enum from this enum player info action. We also send along this entity player so that the client knows exactly what player has been added to the server. Once we create our packet, we call the send packet method, which just sends along that data to a specific player. You can see a little bit more of that in the NMS helper class. So this is the send packet method. Again, you can look at all of this if you make it to the end of the video and find the GitHub information. Now that we've sent this information packet to a player, we now need to tell the player that this entity has spawned in the world. To do this, we use the packet playout named entity spawn, which takes in the entity player again, and then we send along that packet, just like the packet playout player info. Now, you could actually stop right here and you'd have an NPC spawn in your world, but there would be two problems with it. The first problem is that the head rotation of this player would be incorrect. And the second problem is that their helmet layer, if they have any, would not display correctly. There's also a few other options that I've added in using some more NMS, which will help you hide the name tag on a player and disable collisions. But before I continue, make sure to subscribe to this channel and like the video so that I know you enjoyed it and I can make more just like this one. So continuing on, we grab the Craft Scoreboard Manager, again from our Craft server here. Then we get a Craft Scoreboard, which is actually our main scoreboard from the Scoreboard Manager. And then we get the Minecraft or NMS representation of the scoreboard. Now, this scoreboard might look like it's coming from Bucket, but if we actually look into it a little deeper, you'll notice it's in the NMS package. Now that we've grabbed our scoreboard, we can actually create a scoreboard team, which is where we'll set up our different options, like hiding a name tag or disabling collisions. To do that, we just need to grab the team from the scoreboard using the entity's name as the team name. This may or may not be null. It depends on if you have an NPC with the same name as this one. In that case, your team will already exist. Otherwise, we just create a new one here by calling new scoreboard team, passing in our scoreboard that this team is a part of, as well as the entity name, which will be the name of our team. From there, we can set our name tag visibility based on this hide name tag boolean that we have as a part of this class. If that's true, we're going to set tag visibility to never, which means don't display name tags at all, or we can set it to always, which will display name tags all of the time. Similar to name tags, we can just turn off collision by sending the collision rule to enumteampush.never. Finally, there are two other properties we want to set up on our scoreboard team if hide name tag is true. First, we'll set the color of the team to gray so that the NPC has a gray name. And then we're going to add a prefix which indicates to everyone on the server that this is an NPC. This will only show up in the tab list, and we're actually going to remove the NPC's listing from the tab in just a little bit, so don't worry if you don't include this part of the code. So now that we've created our scoreboard, we actually need to tell the player that this NPC is being shown to that this new scoreboard exists, and we also need to give it its options. To do this, we'll use the Packet Playout Scoreboard Team. We're going to send three Packet Playout Scoreboard Teams. One of them will create the team, the second will set up the options on the team, and the third will add the player or the NPC to the team's entry. So that all this applies to our NPC specifically. So the first packet is packet playout scoreboard team with our scoreboard team as the first option and the number one as the second. This indicates to our client that we're creating a new team. The second packet is the same packet with our team, except this time there's a zero. This will make sure that the options of the team get transferred over as well. And the third has three parameters in the constructor. Again, the team, and then a singleton list of the entity name, because teams can have multiple entries. In this case, it's only going to have our one NPC. And then we're going to finish that off with a three to indicate that we are adding an entry to our scoreboard team. With that, we are done creating our scoreboard team. Now, you can actually remove all this code safely. It only does some small little tweaks that I think are really great on our NPC project here, but we actually don't need this, and you can safely remove the code. Okay, so before we keep going with our show method, we're going to take a break and build a few other methods out that will help us with our show method, making sure that our entity's head gets rotated correctly and fixing our skin layer. Our first method is send head rotation packet. This gets the location of the NPC and then makes sure it's facing in the player's direction. From there, we're going to grab the yaw and the pitch of the location, convert them into a byte format that our packets can accept, and then we're going to send the packet playout entity head rotation with our entity player and the yaw. And we're also going to send packet playout entity look with the ID of our NPC here, the yaw, the pitch, and a false boolean. All of that together will make sure that our NPC looks in the direction of a player. We'll call this every few ticks to make sure that continuously updates to get that effect I was talking about where the player can move and the NPC's head will follow. Next, we need to fix the helmet layer on our NPC. To do this, we need to send what's called a metadata packet. You can learn a little bit more about this at the wiki.vg, which I'll link below. Wiki.vg contains a lot of useful information for working with NMS, specifically with how the Minecraft packet system works and what different options do. I highly recommend looking at the website if you work with NMS or you're looking to get into it. So using wiki.vg, this right here is our skin fix byte. So it is a combination of 0x1, 2, 4, 8, 10, 20, and 40. All of this together results in a byte of 127 when you use these pipes here. And 127 will make sure that all of our skin features are turned on as well as the cape. Then we're going to send a metadata packet using the player. The index is 16. This is the skin change index. Again, you can find that information on wiki.vg. And then we'll pass along our skin fix byte. The actual send metadata method here grabs the entity player's data watcher. From there, we grab the data watcher serializer of type byte. And then we're going to get that from data watcher registry.a, which is a static variable here. Then we're going to set some options on the data watcher. We're going to set the first parameter to registry.a. We're going to pass in the index here, and then we're going to pass in the byte, which I've named O. Once we've set that on the data watcher, we can then send the metadata packet, which contains the ID of our NPC, the data watcher itself with our information about the metadata byte that we're sending over, as well as a boolean of false. And then obviously we just follow that up with sending the packet. Now, if you're wondering where a few of our methods are coming from, I've got them right down here. So this is how we get the location from our entity player. This takes the entity player's location info and converts it into a bucket location, which can be used like any other location in your plugin. To do this, we just grab the entity player's world and then we call get world on it again. This will return a bucket world that location will accept. Then we'll grab the X, Y, and Z coordinates of our entity player, as well as its yaw and pitch. And then all of that gets wrapped up in the location constructor and then sent back to whoever needs it. Get ID is super simple. We just call entityPlayer.getID. Then at the bottom, we have this send packet method. All this does is call NMS helper's version of send packet, but I've wrote this in our class, so I have a nice easy way to access it later. So now with all of that out of the way, we can finally finish off our show method using all of the methods that we filled in before. We're gonna schedule three distinct tasks here. Our first task will rotate the NPC's head every 2 ticks. You can obviously adjust it, but I found that 2 ticks works pretty good. First, we're going to grab the player using bucket.getPlayer, and then we're gonna pass in the player's unique ID here. Then we're gonna check if they're null or not offline, or if they've stopped being a viewer of this NPC. If any of those are true, we're going to cancel this task because we no longer are showing this NPC to this player, and we don't need to rotate this NPC because there is no player to send this packet to. If all of that returns false, we can just send that head rotation packet, which we wrote a little bit earlier, to make sure that the NPC follows when a player moves around. Our next task is a delayed task to hide the NPC's name from tab. Again, this is one of those optional things, but I highly recommend it so you only have real players in your tab list rather than a whole bunch of NPCs. Just like we added the player using a packet playout player info, we're going to remove the player from the tab using the same packet with the remove player enum instead of add player. It takes in an entity player just like before, and then we can send that packet just like we have been. I've set the delay on this method to 20 ticks, which equates to 1 second, and I found this is pretty good. You can run into some issues if you go a little bit faster than 20 ticks, so you'll want to play with this number and make sure that everything is working good for your server. Though I wouldn't recommend going below 20 ticks. Finally, our last delayed task will happen 8 ticks after we schedule it, and this will just send the fix skin helmet layer packet to our player to make sure that all of the helmet and the other body pieces on a skin show up correctly for our NPC. And that is almost it in our NPC class. There's one other thing that's pretty useful to note, and that's the hide method. This just sends out the packet playout entity destroy, which just kills the entity player and removes it from the world. And with that, you have written your full NPC class. Now, we have to do a few things to make sure that we can click on the NPC, and this is where Protocol Lib will come in. Protocol Lib is an open source library which helps you interact with the protocol of the Minecraft server. We're going to use it to listen for when the player sends a entity use packet or entity interact packet. We're going to get the ID of the entity the player thinks they're interacting with, as well as how they're interacting with it. And we'll check to see if we have an NPC with that same entity ID. If we do, we can call a custom event that we've made, and then we can handle that event to show an inventory, like on some of those servers I mentioned at the beginning of the video. So how do we write this in code? Well, we're gonna grab the protocol manager from protocol library. This is some protocol lib stuff here. Then we're gonna add a packet listener, and that'll be a packet adapter with our plugin class and the packet type of packet_type.play.client.useEntity. So that means that this onPacketReceiving method will only be called when the player is sending the useEntity packet. Once we've received that packet, we're going to grab the entity use action at index 0 from the packet. So the indexes here just mean the first variable of this type inside of the packet class. Now, these packets that I've been showing you so far, as well as this index of 0 and all sorts of other things about NMS, might change in the future. So I highly encourage you keep watching to the end of the video so you can get all of the up-to-date code, because if this does change, I will update my code. You can find that at the very end of the video. Just keep watching. So what is our entity use action here? This is either interact, interact at, or attack. We'll get to this in a little bit. Then we're gonna grab the entity ID, which will be the first integer. As you can see, we're getting the packet, getting integers, and then reading the first integer value from our packet, and that will be our entity ID. From there, we can call this handle entity click method I've written, passing in the player that's sending this packet, the entity ID, and then we're going to convert protocol lib's use action to one of our own. You can see we have interact, interact at, and attack here, just like the one from our protocol lib library. Handle Entity Click is super simple. It just loops over every NPC we've set up, checks to find one that matches the entity ID. If there is one, we're going to run a delayed task 2 ticks later, and then we're going to handle this event if they haven't clicked on this NPC too recently. I do this little cache trick here to make sure that if there's 2 packets sent, and this could happen where there's an interact and an interact at packet, just making sure that only one of those gets handled by our code. So because we're using a custom event with the bucket event API here, we can handle this just like we would any other event. So we can grab our NPC when there's an interaction here. We're going to check the name of that NPC, make sure it's Technoblade. We're going to make sure the player is not attacking Technoblade, and then using a GUI API that I have open sourced, which I'll link in the description below, we'll open up the server menu GUI, which has a few different options for the player to tinker with. And that's it. So we've created our NPC, we've made sure to handle click events, and everything in between. One final note, I'm going to show you where to get the texture and signature of a skin for your NPC. So once we create this new NPC with our options builder here, we set the texture and signature. This can be found at the session server URL, and I'll link this down below. You just have to change the UUID to the one of the player you're trying to get the skin for. Then you copy the texture value into the texture option here, and the signature value into this signature option right here. And again, if you want to learn a little bit more about the session server as well as game profiles, which is what this logic is linked to here, I'll have a video linked for you at the end of this one. So I know all of that was quite a bit, so let's go ahead and recap what we've done here. We've created a custom NPC and added it to the world, then we've shown it to a specific player, and then made sure it rotates as the player walks around the NPC. And with that, we are done with our plugin. So if we actually log into Minecraft here, you can see we can click on our NPC, and when we click on it, it'll open up a menu. So I promised I would give you the information to get all of this code for yourself at the end of the video. If you join our Discord server, I'll have a utilities channel linked where you can find this NPC API I've written. And this also contains a reflected version, if you're into reflection, of the NPC class. So if you want to use this on multiple different server revisions, this will be the class for you. So you can actually find this NPC API as well as a few of my other APIs and utilities in this utilities channel. And besides that, I highly recommend you join our Discord to get help with your code and ask different questions of everybody else in the community with you. Congratulations on making it to the end of this video. If you want to learn a little bit more about the skins you can apply to NPCs, as well as game profiles, you can go ahead and check out this video where I talk about them in the context of a disguises plugin.